Namaste friends, what we are going to do today is your lesson, India's Foreign Policy and Overview. In your course, India and the World, this is one of the most important topic to take a tour of India's foreign policy. The key objectives of this topic are understanding the meaning and determinants of foreign policy. Then we will see the fundamental principles of India's foreign policy with the principle of change and continuity. Then evolution of India's foreign policy, how foreign policy evolved over a period of time. Important phases of foreign policy, mainly how leadership and government changes reshaped the foreign policy. And then in the last, we will see charting foreign policy in the multipolar world. Now, the fundamental question that we need to ask, what is foreign policy? We need to understand that foreign policy refers to the sum total of principles, interests, and objectives which a country promotes while interacting with other countries. So, no country can live in isolation. They have to maintain certain relationships, either bilaterally or multilaterally, with various countries of the world. As we are social animals and we keep our relationships in society, similarly, countries have to keep their relationships all over the world. Now, obviously, when the situation globally is not static, even foreign policy cannot be static. It keeps on changing according to the changing factors. And those factors are called determinants of foreign policy. What is determinants of foreign policy? There are key four determinants of foreign policy. One is, of course, international environment. As the international situation keeps changing, it impacts foreign policy of every individual country. So, for example, when there was world war-like situation, it impacted foreign policy of different countries. Then we moved on to the Cold War situation, where the entire world was divided between the USA-led bloc and USSR-led bloc, the capitalist bloc and the communist bloc. Again, it impacted the foreign policy. So this is called as the first determinant, called international environment or international conditions. The second key determinant is domestic scenario. Of course, every country has a different system. So, some are dictatorships, some are military dictatorships, some are one-party dictatorships, some are democracies, but within democracies also there are different types of democracies. So, there are bi-party democracies, there are two-and-a-half-party democracies, there are multi-party democracies. Now, as per the domestic situation also, we see the impact on foreign policy. For example, in a parliamentary system, any executive decision taken by a leader has to have a parliamentary approval. So, without building a consensus, it is very difficult to take a decision in a parliamentary system. On the other hand, if there is a presidential system, again a democracy, but president is the executive head and he has enormous powers as far as foreign policy, defense or strategic relations related decisions are concerned. So this domestic scenario obviously has an impact on foreign policy. The last important factor can be ideology, but before that, there is one important factor that has played a very critical role in shaping and determining foreign policy, that is leadership style. Now, for instance, as we all are aware, the first Prime Minister of India, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, is considered as the architect of independent India's foreign policy. But he had a different kind of personality. He was more a kind of an idealist person. He always saw the entire world from the idealist prism. And therefore, using international organizations for conflict resolution was his leadership style. On the other hand, if we see Prime Minister Indira Gandhi's period, then her leadership style was more aggressive, realistic. So she understood the dynamics of Cold War. She understood the dynamics that is being played even in the international organizations. And accordingly, during the Bangladesh War, she effectively used the politics within the United Nations in favor of India. So this leadership style also makes a huge difference when it comes to actual decision making and implementation of foreign policy. And lastly, of course, the ideology. Ideology, because you know, a communist government will not have the similar kind of ideology and foreign policy decisions as a democratic government. Ultimately, foreign policy is a choice. And once you have an ideological prism to see the world, your decisions will change. As I gave an example, the initial Nehru era saw entire Cold War with a different prism. By the time Indira Gandhi took over, you know, though she was tilted towards Soviet Union, as was Pandit Nehru, she was more forthright in accepting it. She openly went with a strategic partnership with Soviet Union. But by the time Cold War ended, we saw Prime Ministers like Narasimha Rao or Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and now Prime Minister Modi, their leadership style was different. And of course, in case of Mr. Vajpayee and Prime Minister Modi, even the ideology is different. They see the world differently because of the cultural nationalist position their party holds. So all these determinants have a huge impact on foreign policy of any country. That is true even with India's foreign policy. Now, we have seen these determinants in detail. Now, I would request, if you apply this to the various era of post-independent India, you will be in a better position to understand how these determinants have impacted India's foreign policy. I'm not saying these are the only factors, because economy, petroleum prices, World Trade Organization like organizations, World Bank, model of economic development, even the national culture, like for example, Japan has a different kind of culture. So post-World War period, Japan came up with a technological revolution to reassert itself in the international scenario. So they used technology as a tool. And now we are seeing another determinant in foreign policy as a new pole, where you know, the tech giants like Facebook or Twitter or Google are playing a critical role in impacting your foreign policy. So we have to keep this in mind, that this is a changing thing. But even in this change, there are certain fundamentals that continues over the period of time and that are shaped by certain factors. Similarly, India also has certain principles or factors that has been constant over the period of time. And there are reasons for this. Simply because we have a legacy of the freedom struggle. So from day one, or in fact, even before that, before independence, our foreign policy objectives were defined by the Prime Minister, the interim Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, when he said anti-colonialism, anti-imperialism, anti-racialism. So it became a very critical foundation of our foreign policy. That's why many countries who were facing the challenge of colonialism, they saw India as a strong support for their struggle against the colonial powers. At the same time, We believed in the concept of representation. We had a strong cultural milieu for democracy. We believed in the civilizational concept of Sabha and Samiti. And therefore, promotion of democracy has also become a very critical factor as a principle in our foreign policy. Then we believe that if India has to play an important role and the world has to be in a peaceful environment, then international organizations have a critical role to play. So even before independence, right from 1945, India played very important role in shaping United Nations. The organizations like ECOSOC, Economic and Social Council, India played a very important role in shaping that. Then another principle of India's foreign policy has been peaceful means of conflict resolution. So whenever and wherever possible, India always, and that is enshrined in our constitution also, Article 51, if you see, then it is clearly mentioned what are the objectives of our foreign policy. India also pushed for equitable path of development, and most importantly, India also looks for independent foreign policy. So this is a very critical factor which has shaped India's foreign policy narrative over the period of time. Because please try and understand, when we got independence, there was a Cold War already beginning. So keeping that autonomy, keeping that independence without joining any military bloc was a very, very important decision. Many people consider this to be idealistic, but if we analyze that critically, then we will realize that there was some element of realism in that. Because we wanted to attain certain objectives of our foreign policy. Like, for example, of course, preservation of national interest. So we thought instead of spending on military expenditure and defense infrastructure, we should invest more in socio-economic parameters. And therefore, we avoided joining any bloc. Similarly, our interest was getting benefits from both the blocs. So certain things could be achieved from with relationship with European Union and the United States, while some support we got in terms of defense infrastructure and technology from USSR also. So we wanted to take benefits from both the blocs. So there was a positive, constructive decision of not joining any bloc. Of course, as I said, achievement of world peace through international organizations, then promoting disarmament, fostering cordial relations with other countries. All these were critical objectives. Then solving conflicts by peaceful means. We signed the Panchashila Agreement with aggressive country like China, and we adhered to that. Then sovereignty and equality of all nations. If we know, we have learned even at the graduation level, there was an initiative by India of South-South cooperation against the developed countries. So it was again a very important initiative. Then independence of thought and action as per the principles of non-alignment. So we are not joining any bloc. So we have independent thinking. We will take decisions issue by issue. So Korean War, we played a critical role, in calming down the tension in the Korean Peninsula. Similarly, we remained non-aligned, but we didn't remain neutral. We had a proactive role to play. We eventually built a bloc called G77, which played a critical role, newly developing countries. So equality for them, equal status for them in international relations, and India virtually got the leadership of that bloc. So we can overview this entire period broadly in six phases, though there are some sub-phases in this: Nehru era, Indira Gandhi era, Rajiv Gandhi era, Narasimha Rao era, coalition era, and then now what we are going through as the Modi era. When it comes to Nehru era, Nehru had formulated the basic foreign policy outlines in a broadcast from New Delhi on 7 September 1946, where the objectives and the principles that I have already discussed, he had already outlined even before independence. These goals, of course, included end of colonialism, racism, independence from power blocs, and close ties with China and Asian neighbors. This thinking eventually became a basis for 1954 agreement with Chiang Wen-lai. Chiang Wen-lai and Nehru agreement, which is essentially limited to Tibet, laid down the principles of Panchsheel. Now, there were many thinkers who criticized this stand of Pandit Nehru. Sardar Patel himself took a stand in the initial phase. Later, even Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar criticized this because he was of the opinion that China can't follow Panchsheel and China will be interventionist. Eventually, that came out to be true. We will see that later. But we clearly see that Pandit Nehru had a strong thinking about relationship with Asian neighbors, strong relationship. His leanings towards Marxist thought was obvious, but at the same time he was influenced by liberal democracy. So he came out with his ideology of democratic socialism. I'm deliberately highlighting these factors because just to make you understand how ideology and leadership style plays a role in shaping the foreign policy. That time there was a strong influence of the Cold War environment. So Seato, Santo, you know, all these treaties were signed and one bloc was guided by the USSR, the other bloc was guided by the USA and later European countries also very forcefully joined. And Germany, the Berlin Wall, East and West Germany became virtually the dividing line of two blocs. And India was one such country which decided not to join anything, and Nehru was primary reason for that. Nehru, though, wanted to have a strong relationship with Asian countries, but in practice, if we analyze carefully, his you know, in his period, relationship with the eastern side of India, if you see entire Southeast Asia up to Japan, was always minimal. It was highly influenced by the Cold War politics, and India's foreign policy was mainly largely westward looking. There was another factor in the Nehru era which became a thorn of contention and became a talking point in India's foreign policy, that is India-Pakistan relations. India-Pakistan war immediately after independence, partition had taken place and Jammu Kashmir became a critical issue. So infiltration and then later cross-border terrorism, this became the critical issue. Again, Nehru as an idealist went on to go to United Nations to deal with this issue, and Pakistan didn't accept the dictates of United Nations, which was withdrawal of the forces from there, the illegal occupation of Jammu Kashmir. Then India will keep the forces there to maintain the order, and eventually there will be referendum. But Pakistan never followed the first condition, and eventually United Nations also accepted that now we are out of this entire issue. Now we are seeing a new turn after Article 370 is withdrawn. But this was rooted in this one decision of going to international organizations. Similarly, Panchsheel Agreement and Tibet issue is still a very critical point, whether what we are seeing now on LSE, de-escalation and growing tensions between India-China war, Panchsheel Agreement and Tibet issue was an important factor. Amidst testing time, we charted our territory and faced 1962 war. Nehru couldn't take that shock because our defense forces were not given enough equipments. We were hoping that peacefully we can manage everything. And finally, Indian government had to accept the defeat, though our armed forces had shown a great valor on all the fronts. But political will was not there to fight out against communist China. Seeing this situation, 1965, Pakistan also dared to war against India. This was a Shastri era because 1964, Pandit Nehru was already, he passed away. And amidst this question of who after Nehru, Shastri tried to find a new way. Economically, situation was not very good. We were facing severe drought conditions in many parts of India. Agriculture or food crisis was there. And in this scenario, Pakistan took a chance. But again, our armed forces had shown great, valor and defeated Pakistan on all Western fronts. Lal Bahadur Shastri's leadership turned out to be more decisive and inclusive. He took everybody on board. But ultimately, he had to go down under the pressure of international players. And he went on to Tashkent to sign an agreement where, unfortunately, he mysteriously died in Tashkent. So we don't know. Unfortunately, Shastri got a very small period. And again, we were pushed into a testing time where Mrs. Indira Gandhi took over as the Prime Minister. Socialist policies, she adopted domestically, and first time India openly joined the, not officially, but at least signed a treaty with Soviet Union. So Indo-Soviet Friendship Treaty became kind of hallmark and official acceptance because US was hell-bent on telling that if you are a democratic country, then you should join one side. India always tried to maintain, but that inclination, that leaning was always under question. Domestically, socialistic policy started with the nationalization of banks and cancellation of Privy Council and more inclusion of communist voices in the country. There were allegations of external interventions also. There were some secret reports that Soviet Union infiltrated in the Indian system. And that became a huge talking point then. But during this period, the refugee crisis started on the eastern border thanks to the policies of West Pakistan in the then East Pakistan, which later became Bangladesh. So huge influx of people thanks to the military abuses of Pakistan. So many Bengali-speaking Hindus as well as Muslims were forced to enter into Indian territory. India worked out a grand strategy in the United Nations. Indira Gandhi is known for that decisive role she played. Sam Manekshaw, Air Marshal, Field Marshal Sam Manekshaw played a very important leadership role in this war. And within 13 days, we defeated Pakistan, and Bangladesh was created as an independent country. So there was a turmoil, and in this scenario, Mrs. Gandhi had dissolved the parliament and went for the elections. Obviously, she got the on the background of this war, she got the full-fledged majority. But later, the democratic setup was subverted due to emergency, and then Janata government came into existence. There was some course correction as far as the domestic policies are concerned, and realignment with China is concerned. There, the then foreign minister in Morarji Desai government, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, played a critical role. But again, a very small period, and because this was a multi-party government, Janata government was not one party, but it was, contradictory ideologies coming together. So there was no clear direction in this government. Rajiv Gandhi era, because meanwhile, Indira Gandhi came back, but she was assassinated in 1994, and then Rajiv Gandhi came to power. It was also beginning of the end of Cold War. Domestic turbulence was also there, though Rajiv Gandhi had a full-fledged majority. So he had more options to work out as far as domestic as well as foreign policy is concerned. So he tried to reconnect with China. 1987 was an important step. To some extent, in the fields of technology, he started opening up the market. he started looking at India as more open economy rather than the socialist economy. There were many internal challenges for him, and various charges of corruption by his own defense minister, VP Singh, ultimately led to the completion of the term, and virtually we entered into a phase called coalition politics. There was a minor phase of confusion and economic crisis during the VP Singh and Chandrasekhar government, and by the time 1991 election came up, Narasimha Rao took over as the leader of the minority government of Congress. But he took some important decisions despite these challenges. So, end of Cold War, forced liberalization, Lucas policy, turbulence in a democratic setup, and beginning of the coalition period. This can be described as the critical hallmarks of Narasimha Rao government. So, in the coalition government, lack of full majority is an important issue. We have experienced that. Still, Gujral doctrine came up, and he sought to build trust between India and neighbors, even compromising on certain issues. Vajpayee era saw Pokhran II, a nuclear doctrine, Lahore, Kargil, and aftermath. So we actually started repositioning ourselves. Ideology played a very important role there. If you really want to assert yourself, you have to talk about peace from the position of power. So nuclear test was that showing the position of power. India suddenly became a very important talking point. So on the one hand, emerging economy, on the other hand, a nuclear power. So both these things brought India into a discussion of multipolar world. In the UPA, by and large, the policy continued, but the position of the government was comparatively weak because it was supported by the left parties. There were certain restraints. Still, positive engagement with the USA continued, but this era was marred by the terror and violence, especially from Pakistani side. Then comes the Modi era, where full majority government came with a strong leadership. First time, cultural diplomacy takes a front seat. Yoga becomes a critical factor. For example, now in post-COVID situation, we are seeing vaccine maitri becomes a critical factor. And the main reason for this is Prime Minister Modi started de-hyphenating bilateralism. So if we want to engage with Japan, China can't hold us back. It will not be determined by China factor. If we want to engage with Israel, Palestine will not be a factor. So no compromise on cross-border terrorism. So isolation of Pakistan started. We articulated our Indo-Pacific policy. The new engagement in the entire neighborhood started, especially in West Asia. Lucas became activist and dealing with expansionist China on equal footing, and preparing for the multipolar world became a very important talking point for India. So it was a clear shift in India's foreign policy positioning. So seeing all this narration, we understand that Indian foreign policy has undergone many radical challenges in the past 74 years, in fact, as per the international situation, domestic conditions, leadership styles, and ideologic position. Yet, Indian foreign policy is woven within a framework of autonomy and independence, consensus building, peaceful coexistence, and effective role of international organizations. India is working to assure a multipolar world. So India is playing very cleverly now, though talking about Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, though talking about peaceful coexistence and international organizations, we are emerging as an important player, as we can see now in formation of Solar Alliance, for example. So India is asserting its civilizational identity. The society is more coherent, more aware of international developments. Of course, social media is playing a critical role. So in the framework of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, India is trying to forge a new kind of role for itself. So we are clearly seeing that there is a constant change, but the fundamentals, the civilizational fundamentals of peace, stability, and coexistence for larger good of humanity remain the constant philosophical guiding principle of India's foreign policy. I hope you have enjoyed this session on India's foreign policy. Thank you.